أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون. Chapter 3 verse 104. German translation. Und unter euch soll eine Gruppe sein, die dazu auffordert, Gutes zu tun und die Gutes auferlegen. Und das Schlechte verbieten, und das sind die Erfolgreichen. English translation. And from among you there should be a party who invite to good and enjoin the right and forbid the wrong. And these are they who are successful. Respected elders, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. Now you may be wondering, why did I recite the verse in German? There's two reasons. Firstly, the Quran that I got the Arabic quote from was a German Quran. And secondly, because the topic of my speech is a history of the Berlin Muslim mission. The verse I recited is relevant to propagation of Islam in Germany, which occurred and is indeed still occurring with the Berlin Muslim mission. Having visited the mosque, or Berliner Moschee, as they call it, I wanted to really understand why and how the MDR Muslim mission developed in Berlin. Germany. We always hear about the wonderful architecture of the mosque and the good work going on. But how did we end up in Germany? And how did the MDR Muslim mission spread to Berlin? I will discuss who the major players were in the setting up of the Berlin Muslim mission, the problems faced, and how the mission was established. In May 1922, a well-known English daily of India, the Mohammedan, published an article with the heading, "The Need for the Propagation of Islam in Germany." So I'll just read out a section from this article. And I quote, "Among all the countries of Europe, there does not appear to be as much scope for the propagation of Islam as there is in Germany. She suffered defeat in the war, that is the First World War, and now she is seriously rethinking of rebuilding her future course in order to usher in a new era of peace and prosperity. Everyone here is convinced that rebirth is not possible without following true religion. Christianity has met with complete failure. Germany is in a much better position to reach out to the core of the veritable reality underlying false and baseless propaganda. Germany is the center of Europe, and to achieve success here will have very healthy influence on the neighboring countries." It was clear to people such as Professor Abdul Jabbar Khairi that there was scope for the propagation of Islam in Germany. Arguably, he was the individual that sowed the seeds for the Muslim mission in Berlin. In February 1920, around 2 years before the article was written, Professor Abdul Jabbar Khairi happened to meet a German Muslim, Dr. Khalid Banning, and seriously contemplated the prospect of setting up a mission in Berlin. Around the same time, he had a German lady write letters to Woking, where Mulana Mustafa Khan was the imam, strongly recommending the setting up of a mission in Berlin, similar to the pattern of the Woking Muslim mission in England. Professor Abdul Jabbar then set up planning the setup of the mission with the assistance of the German lady who had sent him the letters. Having completed his plan, Professor Abdul Jabbar sent it to the Woking, from where his plan reached Lahore to be considered. The MDR Anjuman Ishaat Islam Lahore carefully considered the feasibility of the plan before accepting it. Following that, Hazrat Mulana Muhammad Ali, the then head of the Lahore section, made a special appeal for donations during the annual conference in December 1921 for the opening of missions both in America and Germany. Thus, the Berlin Muslim mission was born. Interestingly, the very man who instigated the Berlin Muslim mission, Professor Abdul Jabbar Khairi, was a non-Ahmadi. Though he may be credited with the inception of the Berlin Muslim Mission, he later became a thorn in the side of the Emdia Muslim Mission in Berlin. The Khairi brothers, including Professor Abdul Jabbar Khairi himself, who had so far been persuading the Emdia Anjuman Ishaat Islam, Lahore, to set up a mission in Berlin on the pattern of Woking, from December 1922, began to oppose the project tooth and nail. The third brother, Abdul Ghaffar Khairi, through the Delhi Khilafat, Bombay and Ahle Hadith, Amritsar and Delhi, expressed resentment and accused the Ahmadiyya Anjuman in Lahore of foiling efforts of their brother by setting up a mission themselves. So he tried instead to mislead the Muslims by writing, "Any assistance given to this Ahmadi set, which has made an appeal for a mosque, would result in discord and division among the Muslims, because this sect would present Islam according to its own faith and ideology." Likewise, Mr. Abdul Ghaffar Khairi published articles against the mission in the Daily Zamindar of Lahore. Not content with that alone, Mr. Rashidul Khairi even went to the extent of labelling the proposed mosque as Masjid-e-Zarar, which meant that this mosque was being built to cause disruption among Muslims. With scant regard for the opposition, Maulana Sadruddin, who was the first imam at Berlin and is considered the founder of the Emdia Muslim Mission in Berlin, and Maulvi Abdul Majid, the assistant imam, continued their search for a suitable site. They also met the Muslim ambassadors and delegates in Berlin. The ambassador of Turkey highly encouraged the Maulana and assured him of all possible help for the construction, and continued to support him up to the stage of the completion of the mosque. In July 1923, a 2-acre parcel of land belonging to the local municipal committee was purchased. The land was situated in an upmarket area. Its importance can be judged from the fact that the construction of a church was first proposed on the land, but as God Almighty would have it, the proposal could not materialize, and the same land was purchased for the construction of the mosque. It was Hazrat Maulana Sadruddin's earnest desire to construct the mosque on this particular piece of land, and he strove hard for it, so that the mosque and the mission could benefit from the importance of the site. The site was surrounded on three sides by roads. While there were lush green gardens on its fourth side, the land was, in all respects, best suited and ideal for the mosque. Hazrat Maulana Sadruddin now started to think about the construction plan for the mission house and the mosque, keeping in view the Mughal architecture exhibited by the Taj Mahal at Agra and the Badshahi Mosque in Lahore. Work on the plan made steady progress. At this juncture, Maulana Sadruddin met a Russian scholar, Mr. Lufta Bey. The building plan of the mosque was completed in September 1923 and was sent to Lahore so that Hazrat Maulana Muhammad Ali could bless it with his formal approval. In November 1924, preparations for the stone laying ceremony of the mosque were in progress. The ambassador of Turkey was to be the chief guest. An unknown Egyptian student, on the instigation of the Khairi brothers, created mischief by accusing Hazrat Maulana Sadruddin through a handbill of being a spy of the British government. The ambassador of Turkey therefore expressed his inability to preside over the ceremony. It had to be postponed, but the construction work on the mosque continued without interruption. In April 1925, main work on the mosque was nearing completion. By now, the vile propaganda of the opponents had completely failed. False and malicious reports sent to the government were thoroughly examined through its embassy in Calcutta and were found to be baseless and malicious. Finally, the suspicion created in the minds of the government authorities was dispelled. Consequently, the German government issued orders for the deportation of the Egyptian student. A German citizen was issued stern warning and action was taken against other miscreants. All this on the part of the government went a long way in removing many of the hurdles and creating a favorable atmosphere for the mission. By the grace of God, on 26th April 1925, the opening ceremony of the Berlin Mosque finally took place. Nowadays, the Berliner Moschee at Brunnerstrasse is open to everyone. Many visitors, Muslim and non-Muslims, are welcomed by our current Imam at Berlin, Ahmed Sadat. Among the most notable visitors to the mosque during the time of Maulana Muhammad Yahya Bhatt included the President of Somalia, Adil Abdullah Osman, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Tunku Abdul Rahman, and the former Foreign Minister of Pakistan, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. No doubt if we continue to radiate the true teachings of the Quran, not only will we continue to be visited by more guests, but joined by ever more members. I hope that we continue to propagate the true message of Islam, regardless of how many people try to taint our character, no matter how much hateful propaganda is exercised against us, regardless of how many minarets are destroyed by bombs, because as the Berlin Muslim mission has proved, Inna Allaha Ma'ana, Allah is with us. So,